So where we last left our band of intrepid adventurers, they had safely seen their charge, the discovery, the girl Lola, that was living in and around the swamp and the corrupted area of the forest. They brought her back to the safety of the Elven Enclave, and shortly after their arrival there, a green, what appears to be mesh, or a kind of field of arcane creation, built itself up around the village shortly after their arrival. They spoke to a few members of the party, spoke to some of their allies within town, and they eventually all of them reconvened inside the Argent Grove, where the druid was currently having a meeting with a rather unpleasant individual who, in her opinion, thinks that Lola should at this point just be killed, given that the revelation of what Lola really is. And Lola is essentially a hag waiting to be born. Their transformation occurs 13 years after the child is kidnapped and consumed by the hag, and the 13th year is approaching, seemingly approaching, for Lola. She's begun to manifest signs of her change. As such, the party has been motivated to try and find a way to cure her. During this, Theon encountered one of his old teachers from the Arcanum Spires, and there was made mention of an ancient series of artifacts dating back to the origins of the kingdom called the Hearts of Creation, which may hold the power to potentially save Lola. Before she disappeared around the corner, led by the druid who had promised to the party to, as long as she was not a threat to anyone, that he would keep her safe. And with those assurances, she was led from the grove and out of the sight of the party. Theon, deciding to seek out the herbalist, has left the grove and headed back towards the stone promenade. The rest of the party finds itself within the Argent Grove, standing beneath the branches and boughs of the Argent Oak, the spring slowly burbling up and trickling down the rock outcropping that is on the opposite side of the grove and forming a small pool. The raised mound of earth that everyone finds himself standing on is soft and lush, and as the evening begins to set in and a few stars peek out amongst the clouds, the party finds itself wondering what its next move will be. Theon is currently leaving the glade. He has not left just yet, but he's on his way out. And he's clasping in his hand a bundle of the mycelium that had been trimmed and secured from the forest a few days prior. Theon, before you can finish leaving the grove to pursue the herbalist, hopefully his shop is still open at this point at night, you are caught on your sleeve of your new robe. And as you turn in surprise and startled, you see the hand of the elderly gentleman you've only been introduced to recently, named Honos, who seems to stop you for a moment and then presents to you a small silver mirror.
Is there any reason to why you would want me to do this? I grab the mirror and take a look into it and think of Alea.
Theon, as you peer into the surface of the mirror, initially nothing remarkable happens. It's quite well crafted. The entire thing seems to be made of pure silver, and the surface of the mirror itself is flawless. As you look at your own reflection, however, it seems that your reflection actually distorts a little bit and shimmers and begins to move slightly, as if the surface of the mirror itself goes from something solid to something liquid and begins to undulate with small waves and troughs. Your perspective seems to get pulled inwards, looking deeply into your own eyes in the reflection, the distorted reflection of the mirror. Suddenly your surroundings are dark. In fact, all around you is an infinite plain of black, save a few things that do stand out. To your right is a very large, very distinct eyeball looking straight at you. Makes no noise, has no movement, is just staring at you. To your left is a sphere made of smoke and fog, and appears to be slowly dissipating.
And as am I able to recognize the eye at any kind of coherence?
Make an arcana check.
Nope.
All right, make a... Okay, make an intelligence check after this.
The pity check.
I was going to get advantage, but there was no reason. So you can't recognize what spell this is, but you know you've seen this before. You're certain of it. And then it hits you. This is the thing that popped out of the chest when you guys opened it. When Mindardus went to open the chest that was found in the hag's hut, a small sphere coalesced in the air above the chest as some kind of spell was triggered as a result of the opening of the chest. It formed that kind of lizard eye pupil, the vertical slit along the surface of the sphere itself, and you realize that you're staring exactly at that object. It's the same thing. And you know that. And as you come to this realization, you're surprised for a moment, but your attention is drawn immediately away by a heavy sigh of a female voice. And as you snap your head to the right, looking at the source of this, you see very crisp and clear the exact image of your mother.
Oh, God.
And as you walk towards her...
Am I able to... I guess, cast any spells or at least manipulate the surroundings there? Or do I have no control over anything?
You try to manifest some of your arcane power, and it comes to no effect at this place. Your mother, who is initially looking down and trying to cradle a couple of small children in her arms, is sitting on a dirty bench locked in a cell. And where initially you walked up to her and you tried to reach out and touch her, your hand passed through her. But as you did so, you realize your surroundings have changed again. This infinite space of blackness is no longer there. You're distinctly within a cell. And you hear the kind of creaking and a rattling of chains.
Is this cell stone? Is it wood?
The walls are not made of naturally occurring stone. This is raw rock. And the bars themselves seem to have been very haphazardly and in a very brutish and kind of forceful manner just sunk into the rock, jammed in place. And it seems like this is more of a ramshackle construction of a cell. It's going to hold whoever's in it. But it was not, no part of this was machined out. There was no mason to craft this cell or lay bricks and mortar. There was likely no architect. It seems to be a conversion of a natural alcove in the rock, repurposed for containment.
Can I try shouting out to my mother?
You call out your mother's name, and for a moment her head stirs, and she looks vaguely in your direction. Eyes half closed, almost as if she wasn't sure that. And you can hear her say, "Theo." You hear very faintly your voice, but you can tell from the tone that she's uncertain if she even heard anything. The sound of creaking and rattling gets closer. And you hear a hollow voice begin to emit itself from down the hall.
No.
And as it spins around, this dark-robed figure is standing on the other side of the cell wall, staring down at your mother and the two children she has cradled in her arms.
I am something different.
And a skeletal hand reaches forward and rests its bony fingers on the iron bars.
You come to understand in time. Though your fate is not those that will soon join us and have before. You are different. You are special. You will join our family. The time is fast approaching, young elf.
Can I see which elf he's talking about? Is there any?
He is looking straight at your mother. There is nobody else that you have any misconception of who he's speaking to.
She is not that young.
This creature seems to view her as such.
Yeah.
You hear other voices call out from down the hall. It seems to momentarily distract this robed figure. As he drifts away again, you hear the creaking of just friction of dry surface against dry surface. You hear the dull rattle of chain as it slowly slinks off. You don't hear footsteps, per se, but you do hear the sound of movement. As he goes to speak to this other voice that's emanated, the illusion itself begins to dissolve, and everything around you, the stone walls, the iron bars, all of it begins to simply cascade away like hundreds of pounds of sand and dust just falling vertically through the air. It just begins to dissolve away. And before the vision completely fades, you hear distinctly the voice of your mother.
I know you're coming for me.
And once again, your vision goes black. You take a deep breath in and open your eyes, and once again, you're standing in the grove looking at the surface of a silver mirror, wondering what the hell just happened.
I'd like to say that my character right now, he is still staring at the mirror, trying to maintain his focus on his mother, crying while he's doing it, trying to figure out where she was.
Do I notice that he's come out of his trance?
Honos, you see his perspective, or his face, which, after you handed him the mirror, he began to look intently at it, and then his expression go rather blank, and rather glass-eyed. It lasted for maybe 45 seconds, and then his eyes shot open, and he breathed in sharply, and now he is clutching the mirror with what you would almost label as desperation, but it's more just, it's very, very focused intent, and he is just staring at it, and you can see the welling of water in the bottom of his eyes, and it begins to streak down his face in very, very small rivulets before he brushes it away.
I give him a shake.
I thrust the mirror back in his direction and just kind of look at him and go, "We must find her. She was in the picture. She's being held captive. I do not know where. It looked to be something more like a cave of sorts."
Well, that's something at least. I take the mirror back.
Theon, you giving up the mirror?
Yes, I'm gonna give up the mirror. Is Arari in the immediate vicinity?
Arari has been watching you the entire time, and for the first time in the history of you two knowing each other, she looks legitimately concerned about your well-being.
I explained to her in full detail what had happened, what I had saw about the eye, the cell, my mother, and what was being said.
The halfling seems to take in all the information and Now that she has something to focus on and something to actually attend her mind to, she seems to be able to separate herself from the emotional distress that was visibly on her face as a result of seeing your reaction to whatever was in that mirror. And she's able to go back into a much more kind of authoritative body posture. And she says, after clearing her throat, almost like she's lecturing students, "Well, the smoke sounds like an arcane eye. But those spells usually don't last too long. Did you see anything in the eye itself? Did you even look?"
I don't believe I did. I tried to. I noticed it as an eye that we had seen before upon opening a chest.
This was the same chest we got the mirror out of, right?
This was the same chest you got the mirror out of. So, upon hearing your description, Theon, Arari looks straight at Honos and says, "Can you do that again? Can you look in there again? I don't want him doing that." And she points at Theon. You do it.
Certainly. I pick up the mirror again, look again.
Thank you. And a now somewhat familiar sensation occurs to you, Honos, as you are pulled into this dark plane. And you are standing in an infinite sea of this black fog. To your right is a very clear and distinct eye shape. To your left is this slowly dissipating smoke eye.
I want to look for clues on the outside where this might be. Can I see outside at all?
Everywhere you look around you is darkness. It's kind of like a plane, like it's land that you could theoretically walk into or walk off into, but there is no visual horizon. There is no external light source. You're not even sure how you actually see things right now.
Oh, so I'm not where I was before?
No, you are in a completely different space.
Okay, I start thinking about my apprentice then.
Your perspective is almost pulled away from the direction of the eye and into just an empty space within this dark region that you inhabit. And what resolves in front of you, whereas before it was very fuzzy and indistinct, what resolves now is two humanoid figures, a male and a female. They are huddled in one corner of what appears to be a kind of containment cell with rough hewn rock floor and walls. None of this is manufactured. It all seems to be naturally derived, with rusty iron bars that appear to be jammed in a haphazard fashion, barring the entrance. So it seems to be some kind of containment cell. Not very well constructed, but it will do the job. And the two of them are clutching each other. They're clutching each other in one corner of this cell. The girl, who appears to rouse herself from sleep, looks around analytically. She is in pure hunt mode. She is looking for some kind of weakness, deficiency, fault, some way out of this cell.
Okay.
And as she, yeah?
I wanted to see if I can see outside anywhere, see if I can tell where this is in the landscape.
As you turn around, you can only see a corridor that extends down off into the darkness to your right, and you appear to be in a cell that is at the end of this corridor. However, as you are staring down this, you begin to hear the rush and roar of ocean waves, and you can hear them smash against rock. It's distant, but it's definitely there. You can definitely hear the ocean. And it churns violently and wildly. You can hear the cries of some kind of animal. Make a nature check.
Gotta get my sheet open.
You recognize distinctly the sounds of harpies.
Excellent. I'm gonna start walking towards the sound of the ocean. I don't think I'll get there, but I'll try anyway.
You're walking straight towards a rock face.
Can I walk through the rock face?
As you walk up and you put your hand against it, your hand passes through the rock face. And as you continue walking, you slowly... It's not as if you face resistance, but your mind, it reels for a second. It's like, no, don't walk into a wall. Don't do that. But there is no physical object, and you simply pass right through it. And as the dark blue of the stone begins to work its way towards your vision, it is then it succumbs to just blackness and just dark. And as you slowly push and try and move towards what you think is through this wall, your vision is eventually blinded by bright light. You catch a few glimpses of the harpies that you heard circling above a very distant rock spire that juts up out of the ocean hundreds of feet into the air. And as you look down, you see that there is nothing beneath you. You're standing at the edge of another rock spire, and you begin to plummet towards the ocean.
Oh boy.
At this point, your vision goes dark again, and you, in a very similar reaction to Theon, gasp and rear your head back, and you're all of a sudden standing in the glade as you take two steps back and actually fall onto your butt, toppling over.
I put the mirror down and describe to the halfling the spire, the harpies, and the ocean.
Arari takes in this information and seems to be... There's a look of confusion and surprise on her face. It's a mixture of emotions that it's kind of hard to read. Make an insight check.
Both of us, or...?
Yeah, you can make an insight check too if you'd like. I need to bring up a stat block.
Fourth of July weekend means I won't be able to sleep because fireworks have been going on all night.
Okay, so you rolled an 18.
Do you get, like, PTSD from them or something? Hey there.
Oh my god.
Do you have earplugs? You actually don't feel them after a couple minutes. Well then.
Yeah, I put on TV, and it doesn't matter if the TV's cranked to full, I fall asleep. I need that constant noise.
Well, that's what All you right. do with earplugs.
All right, Honos, as you read the expression off of Arari, you know that she recognized something. Your description, you could see it in her face that it was far too accurate for it to be any kind of guess. And you know that she recognized something out of what you said. Theon, you see in her face a moment of realization that is coupled with a very real sense of dread. And you've never seen Arari show fear before, but she actually becomes a little afraid, and her body posture shifts a little bit, her shoulders roll forward, and her chin sinks a little bit before she clears her throat and tosses her hair about and then makes a really showy point of rubbing underneath her chin and thinking aloud and going, yes, that sounds familiar. That definitely sounds like Sindarin. Yes? Pedwin's not there.
Is this, in my studies, have I ever came up with this?
So... Cinderin, the name definitely pings something familiar in you, Theon, and you, Mindardus. Mindardus, you've been on this island for a long time. You've heard that name before. You were actually here when the disaster struck that split the island. And the name that was given to the site of the fallen capital, the part of the island that was most ruined and devastated, was, in another language, the word for sundered, and that word is Cinderin. You know that place, and Theon, you know this as well, is essentially off limits. No one is permitted to go there, and those that are foolish enough to attempt rarely return. Those that do often talk about horrific creatures and just, no matter what, it's always regret. The journey there is fraught with danger, and what happens when you arrive, nobody really knows, but those people that come back usually come back pretty scarred and never want to return there.
All the more reason to get my mom out of there as fast as possible.
Arari hears this and turns to you rather incredulously, eyes kind of wide. Do you even realize what that means?
I do. But if I have to realize what that means, then my mom also realizes what that means right now.
Am I nearby for all this?
You've overheard everything, Morris.
When she says that, can I lean forward and go, that means it's time to fuck shit up?
I like this man. Bold, straight to the point.
She turns to you and she says, that means your shit's gonna get fucked up. Anyone that I know that has been there has either died or come back so scarred that I don't even recognize the person that's left.
Well, it's not my fault everyone you know is a pussy.
She tosses her hands up in the air. Fine, do what you want. I need to work on these. Is there anything else anyone wanted to run by me before I have to get to work on this? And she points to the journals that had been handed to her from Theon.
I want to ask her how long that's going to take her, and if there was any way that she could help us out with any kind of app or guide.
She thinks for a moment. Well, I can't give you any help at the moment. I'm going to be kind of busy. I have to maintain this field around the village. But it shouldn't take too long to get through at least a couple of these. She starts flipping through some of the journals that you've given her, and a letter falls out from between two of the pages. The book itself that she finds a letter in is just rotted and decrepit by this point. What little writing is left is either faded or the pages have been so damaged that there's no information that can be discerned, but a letter does fall out. She picks it up for a moment and opens it up and then hands it to the nearest person to her, which I guess would be Theon. Well, that doesn't need translating, that's in common, but I could probably have a couple of these done by tomorrow at noon. Does that sound okay? I don't know what you all are getting up to.
I think we're heading to this Cinderin as soon as possible.
We'll be heading to Cinderin's.
Well, if you are that much in a hurry to, die. Well, I don't think you have to go quite that far. From what I've heard, there's a couple of hundred lizard folk that are going to come over here and probably kill us all. So maybe, and hear me out on this, don't go and die there just yet. Stick here. Maybe not everybody dies because you help. And then you can go and die. How's that?
Would you like, to come along with us, Arari?
Nope. And for the first time, a legit and genuine smile comes across her face as she says that in response. I have work to do. I have a job. I like being alive.
How about being alive in the bedroom?
I would like to try to coerce...
Come down there, buddy.
...guilt trip her as well and go, yeah, so does my mom.
Okay. Make a persuasion check with disadvantage.
With disadvantage.
You are trying to convince her to go into what she considers death. You are certainly at disadvantage for this. Morris, make a persuasion check with disadvantage as well, because you're coming on to her.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, boy.
Persuasion?
It is going to be persuasion, unless you're flat out lying to her, but I don't think you are.
That's close to flat out lying.
He does the eye waggle.
I give her a thumbs up when I say it.
I waggle.
I reach over and put his thumb down.
Upon seeing this, Arari looks at the gesture and the, you know, the posturing, the masculine presence of Morris, and then a little hand comes down and just pushes the thumb down, and she turns her head to you, Honos, and says, "Thank you." She turns to Theon, she turns to Morris and says, "No, thank you," and then turns to Theon and says, "Definitely no, thank you."
Yeah, I look to Big Mo and say, "Hey, you're moving up in the precedence order."
The who?
You didn't get a definitely no, thank you.
Man. Well,
I think the choice between like certain death and sleeping with Morris is one that's probably worse than the other. And at least you know where Arari stands on those particular activities.
Wait a minute. I've traveled the lands in an army and have made love to a lot of women.
Are you saying this out loud?
Very nice.
Postulating this in your head.
I'm saying it out loud.
Okay, so where are you going with this?
I'm just saying, it's not as bad as it sounds.
Arari puts her hands on her hips and kind of cocks her head to the side. I'm sure it's not. When I'm less busy, we'll revisit the idea.
I like that answer.
I would...
When we return from Sindarin, I'll let you reconsider.
If you return from Sindarin.
It's not a matter of if. We are going
yeah.
to.
Oh, it's totally a matter of if. Definitely an
because
if.
We're not a bunch of pussies. Have you seen these muscles? I give her a thumbs up instead of flexing my arms.
At this point, she once again tosses her hands into the air. I have work to do. She turns on a heel, points towards one of the exits of the grove. That-a-way! And she begins just walking off in that direction.
If she's just walking off, I'd like to say one more thing to her and say, well, if there was no way we could convince you on coming with us, I'm sure there were some things in Sindarin that would, I don't know, interest you in your studies. If there was any way that we could keep in contact so we can share things with you, perhaps get a better insight on some of the things we might run into.
As you're going through this sentence, Theon, she is making a show of marching towards that exit. You get about halfway through the sentence to the point of finding things that would help her in her studies, and she just stops rigidly, and you can actually see the leg kind of shake back and forth a little bit in the air with the suddenness of her halt. She puts her foot down and turns towards you. She actually walks up towards you and takes one of your hands in both of her small halfling hands. She looks at you. Theon, if you're going to go there, please be careful. And yes, if you find anything, I'm definitely going to be interested, so bring it to me.
I will.
Okay.
Do.
Okay. She turns on a heel again. That way! And then begins walking off.
Does she actually say that way?
She does.
I'll say out loud, what a strange person.
As she's walking away, she cries out, "You're strange!"
She should have met Pedwin.
She really, really
no,
should have met Pedwin.
She should have not. This is what I've said before we started.
With, like, every character development moment that Pedwin had, I thought, I cannot wait for these two to meet.
Oh my god, I'm so sad now.
Oh well, to each their own. Okay, so. So Arari has just left the glade. Urun, at this point, he has been quiet throughout the whole thing, and he speaks up, clearing his throat and standing up. Morris, he gives you back the wineskin that you gave to him. It is totally empty now. And as he hands it back, you can see he's kind of swaying back and forth a little bit. Doesn't look like he drinks a whole lot. I mean, like, he's a pretty big guy, so he can handle his alcohol, but he doesn't drink a whole lot. So he's got a little smile on his face.
I want to hand the mirror to Arun and tell him to think of his brother.
You shove it into his hand, he's like, what's this?
This might not work, but try and concentrate on your brother.
Okay.
And if you see anything, tell us.
Okay. He moves his face in really close to the mirror, and he closes one eye, and he peers directly at it, and you hear him say in a really loud voice, Rowan! His face goes for a moment a little bit confused, and then his eyes go a little heavy. Almost like he's drowsy. And then his whole face just kind of freezes for a moment, and it doesn't do anything. And you're not even sure that he's breathing at this point. He's so frozen. And Honos, it reminds you distinctly of what happened to Theon. And Theon, you get to see this happen to somebody else. And he just stops moving entirely. His whole body is just paralyzed for a moment. At which point, and after a few tense moments pass, he rears back and drops the mirror.
I try and catch it.
Make a dexterity saving throw.
Oh.
Honos, this thing barely leaves his hand before you deftly swoop it up and place it right back into your bag out of everybody's sight.
Holy shit, old man's got some moves.
Urun just sits down on the ground and is just staring shell-shocked.
We'll try again later.
My brother's dead.
Or not.
Shit.
Those fucking things got him.
The lizard people?
Uh-huh. And you can see now the shell shock is starting to make way. His brow is beginning to furrow. And you hear, you've never heard an adult, or sorry, a teenage boy growl before. But there is something very unnatural about the sound that comes out of this kid.
Am I the only one that knows about his ability?
I think you are.
Okay.
Yeah, I think you are.
You've told me about it. I haven't seen it, though.
Yeah, he's told me about it, too.
Has he told Theon about it?
No, someone said something about him turning into a bear before.
Yeah, but that, I remember that. I watched this video. That was something that Steve-O said, like, to himself. Yeah. That was not something he said out loud. As far as Theon knows, this is a regular kid.
Oh.
However, that perception is about to change. What are you gonna do? What are you gonna do, Morris?
Can I, like, get right in his face and say, now is not the time. They'll be attacking soon. We can do it then.
Make a persuasion check.
God damn it.
Hey, there you go.
Ooh. Thank you.
Minus one.
Yes, I know.
All right, let me find a rune here.
He's gonna nat 20. I can feel it.
Morris, you can see that Urun is breathing heavily. He is And you, as a barbarian, as someone that uses rage as your tool in battle, you recognize the signs of when someone is starting to rage and all sense is beginning to lose them. And you can hear him just breathing increasingly heavy. His fingers are digging deep furrows into the earth beneath him, and he is, every muscle in his body is beginning to flex and tense. And you grab his head and you say this to him very clearly and slowly, and he, for a moment, you don't even think it registers with him, and then his eyes move over to you. Nothing else. He's still staring face forward. His neck is taut with muscle, but his eyes look over at you. And you hear in a much deeper, much more animalistic voice,
"Later."
And with a few very deep breaths, he gradually begins to relax, and you see some of the tension in his muscles begin to slowly seep out.
I hand him the other wineskin.
He just tears the top off of it. There's no cap left. He just rips the wineskin and then just pounds the entire thing back in one go.
There goes your wineskin.
He shoves the remaining one that he drained earlier into your hand.
I think I already had that one.
All right, well, then you have it back now. So you have one wineskin and one destroyed wineskin.
Does Big Mo know sewing?
I will let you make a survival check to try and... Well, actually, do you have, like, a needle and thread?
Am I
you
an
have
arts sewing and crafts supplies? Major?
I can't imagine you could...
Did Pedwin have sewing supplies?
I don't think Pedwin had sewing supplies.
I did not have sewing supplies.
No, I don't.
If we find, perhaps we could find someone in the town who...
I'm not worried about it right now. There's nothing in it, so whatever. I'll let him drink away. I'll let him drink his sorrows away.
And he is doing exactly that. He is not moved from the spot that he's in, and he is just pounding back the ale and the wineskin.
Well, that went well. Let's leave him to that for now.
Let's not let him look in the mirror anymore.
Yeah. I'm on my way.
Great idea.
To the potion guy.
All right, so Theon, after seeing this unfold, you decide this is a good time to leave, and you make your exit and you head back to the promenade where the group first reconvened. And you do notice that the herbalist Phineas is just locking up his shop and he's just stepping out the door for the evening. He hasn't noticed you yet.
Okay. He's locking up for the evening?
You see him, he appears to be, like, closing down shop.
Okay. I shout out to him and I say, "Hey, we brought back some mycelium that you had wanted. Is there any chance that you could, I guess, brew this for tomorrow?"
The herbalist Phineas, with his small little glasses over his crooked nose, he seems to almost, oh, at your arrival, like with a small kind of startled reaction. And he takes the bundles of mycelium and he kind of turns them over back and forth in his hands and he brings them close to his nose and you hear him like, he breaks a small piece off and pops it in his mouth and chews it about a little bit and you can see his eyes kind of curl up into one corner of the eye socket as if he's thinking really hard about the flavor.
Yes. Yes, I can use these. Tomorrow, that might not go. I could. I'd have to work through the night.
Whatever you can do would be most gracious. It's your choice. I just hear that we might have a fight here tomorrow with a bunch of lizards. So, to each their own. And I start walking away.
Wow. That's aggressive much?
Make a persuasion check.
Jesus, you're worse than my mom.
You hear the voice of the elderly herbalist, as he calls out, "Oh, no, wait, wait, wait. I can't have them ready tomorrow morning. Could use what's left of my supplies. I could have maybe two or three ready for you in a day or two's time. That's the best I can do."
Well, then I guess that would work for me.
Okay, then.
I tell him thank you.
Well, I'll take those and drop by in 1 or 2 days and I'll have yourself some potions.
Okay, thank you.
All right. And you hear him begin to kind of grumble to himself as he marches back in and he unlocks the series of locks he used to close up the door, and you hear him disappear into his shop for a moment.
I want to grab Mandardus and ask him if he knows anyone in town who might be able to give us information on how to get to Sindarin or lead us to Sindarin.
I have no idea.
Mandardus, to your knowledge, there are no, there aren't very many sailors as far as the Elven village is concerned. There are, if anyone that's looking to book passage off the island, generally goes to the docks at Mason's Rest or the Port Authority there. There are also there are very few ships that come out of the Dwarven Kingdoms, but most of the commerce between the islands is actually run by the Sethi families. And the Sethi are the group of individuals that you know make their home at the very, very northern reaches of Temek. And you've never been there yourself, but you've heard that their entire city is built on floating rafts. And you know that they are, among sailors, they are the pinnacle. They are the best. It's in their blood right from when they're born.
Question.
Yes.
I think Pedwin had a map that had Sindarin on it that he stole from Navigator Burnley. I don't know if that's correct or not.
You would have to go through Pedwin's things to know.
Well, I'm going to dig through Pedwin's shit.
I had the map in my pack.
You know what? The investigation check's probably not even worthwhile. No, don't worry about it. So you dig through some of the things that that you've picked up from Pedwin. And sure enough, you find a map. And as you open up this map and you unfurl it, what you're looking at appears to be a rough layout of the elven village that you're in.
Huh. Does it say Sindarin on it?
It does not say Sindarin on it. It doesn't say Sindarin anywhere on the map.
But it has the elven map, or the elven village?
It has the elven village.
Is that all it has?
That's all it has right now. And the weird thing is, you looked at this map before and it didn't have the elven village on it. It had Mason's Rest on it.
I walk a couple steps to the right and a couple steps to the left, and it follows me.
The map does not appear to change given the few steps you take.
Okay. Well, I'll roll it up and stick it in my pocket.
All right. You can add to your inventory one map with a little asterisk beside it, because it's a weird map.
Okay. Do I see anything with Sindarin? Do I see any other maps?
You do not see any of the maps in the middle of the glade that you're in, no. The grove.
I'm looking for a map that says Sindarin on it, though, not the grove.
There are no words that are listed on the map you're looking at. It's just based off of your knowledge of the layout of this area, this map corresponds specifically to places that you have walked in this village.
But there's no other map. Like, that's the only map that was in the pack?
That is the only map in the pack.
All right, I'll stop looking. I won't say anything to the other guys. They don't need to know that I didn't find anything.
Okay.
I say we ask around town about anyone who might know how to get to Sindarin.
Is there an
especially if their name is Ben Wiener?
Yep.
Does that bug you that we say Wiener?
No, not at all.
He's probably heard it his entire life, man.
Yeah. Oh, you came up with that one? Holy
so
shit.
Original.
It's not even my last name. It's not even if it was my last name, I guess I would be upset. but it's not even my last name. So.
Dude, I would love the last name Wiener.
You should change your name to Wiener.
You should.
Then I could say.
What's your name where your mouth is?
I would say, would you like to put your mouth where my Steve Wiener's Wiener is?
Steven Zener Wiener.
Steve would see you.
Steven
and, like,
Z Wiener.
You. Steve would push you forward, like when you all get right to the LAN party and go, ask me about him.
Ask me about my Wiener.
Is there an inn or anything like that where I'm at that I know of that I can go sit down and rest?
Most visitors are welcome to stay with the druids as in their lodgings near the grove. Either that or you could try and speak to Peleus again, who has actually left. He didn't stick around. But you could try and speak to Peleus and see if he will put you up for the night.
Well, I guess I'll go back to the grove because I kind of want to, like, sit down and collect my thoughts on the studies and see if I can study anything about Cinderin that I've learned in my studies that I've done.
While he does that, I'll pick up a rune and send him to the druid tavern thing.
All right, so Morris, you help Arun to his feet, and you kind of tug him in the direction that you saw the druid and the druid take Lola a little earlier. As you are rounding the corner, you see a little bit off in the distance, you see the familiar form of Theon start to appear down one of the walkways heading towards this area. And as the two of you basically pass by the same divergence in the path, you see a small building is wooden construction. It appears not made of logs, but of branches that have actually grown together and formed the structure of the building itself. Not necessarily cut and shaped, but they just intertwine and they form the structure of the building themselves. Just these combination of rich, deep browns, earthy greens. There's even kinds of lichens and moss that coat the outside of the building, almost like a kind of insulation. And as you knock on the door, you can hear the tail ends of a low conversation that come to a halt as a result of the sound. Sorwin, you have been going through some of your studies in your room, your area of the dormitory, and the silence of your studies is broken for a moment by the entrance of the druid Dirinor, the one who's been teaching you and kind of leading you in how to become a druid properly. And he's got a young girl clasped in his hand. She looks around 12 or 13. She is in pretty bad condition. She's wearing very shabby clothing. Her hair is disheveled and unkempt. It's dirty. It looks like it hasn't been cut or washed in quite a while. There's a little bit of a smell associated with her, and you kind of wrinkle your nose at it. But she seems genuinely happy, just, if nothing, a little bit concerned and curious as to what's going on around her. You see your tutor exchange a few words with her, and he indicates a hand in your direction. If you need anything, child, speak to my apprentice. His name is Sorwin, and despite his appearances, he is rather friendly. And with that, he nods his head towards the girl. He nods his head towards you, Sorwin, and gives you a kind of look of, like, just look after her. It's kind of what the read that you get off of his face. And then he actually turns and leaves. So Sorwin, you are now, you're in this dormitory, this room with this girl you've never seen before.
Keep in mind she's 13, don't bullish with Panda.
It's never going away, I swear, that is never ever going away.
Oh god.
See, I ask her if she's hungry.
She looks around a little bit and Yeah.
Okay. I go to a table, I pull out some twigs and some delicious looking kale leaves.
That's not what a swift panda is.
And I mash up a delicious salad made from Mother Earth. And I put it in front of the girl.
Make a survival check with advantage.
Hold on, how do I do that?
Bring up your character sheet.
Hold on a sec here.
Keep in mind, you can pop out the character sheet.
I did.
You have more than one monitor. Okay.
Okay. How do I do that?
Okay. To the right of the word survival, there's a little blue button. Just hit the blue button.
Survival.
Okay.
At least.
Survival blue button. Did I do it?
No.
Oh.
It's the little dice.
There you go. You got it. There.
Okay. So, using the ingredients that you have at hand and your knowledge of constructing salads, having done it for years and years and years, you managed to whip together a pretty nice salad.
All right.
And you hand it over to her. She begins consuming it immediately. She's not... There are no utensils. You gave her a fork. She's not using the fork. She's just scooping it into her face.
All right. I wait for her to finish, which was not long.
No, she is ravenously eating it. It is gone in like 2 minutes.
All right. Well?
She reaches the empty bowl out to you with both hands. Thank you.
All right. I go to the tree sink, and I pour out some water and give it to her to wash down the delicious kale Mother Earth salad.
You go to a metal ewer of water and you pour out a glass for her.
Yeah.
This water comes straight from the spring. This is good stuff.
This is good water. Fiji, one might say.
Oh, God.
And I put the water in front of her. Do I have to survival check that?
No, you don't.
Okay.
She greedily gulps down the water and then hands you back the cup. Do you have any more?
I get the largest pitcher I can find, fill it with as much water as it holds, and put it in front of her with a cup. And hopefully satiate her thirst.
She doesn't even acknowledge the cup at this point. She just grabs the ewer and then just lifts up the whole thing and just starts like pouring it, like basically just like chugging the water from this thing. And you can see, like, streams of it are coming out the side of her mouth, and this girl has no manners, from what you can tell. Just zero.
Well, who really has manners nowadays?
Certainly not this one.
Yeah. I guess if we're in for a tale, I feel maybe I am in for a tale. I ask her story. How she arrived at this juncture. Is she too busy to talk?
No,
okay.
she puts down the jug and like wipes her mouth with the back of her hand. You're actually kind of surprised the deftness with which she was able to handle this ewer of water. Like it's fairly heavy, but she was able to move it pretty easily, which is surprising for such a small girl. And she lets out a great big sigh and just burps really loudly, and then kind of like rubs her tummy a little bit. Everybody's asking me about that today. Well, I remember little bits and pieces, but most of what I remember was in the forest with Mother. And her face kind of turns to this, like, frown, and just an expression of a little bit of disgust, almost. And she would have me root around in the dirt looking for stupid mushrooms and roots and finding all sorts of things, and she would make me drink the horrible, horrible, gross things she would make.
We don't have to talk
cauldron.
About that, man. It's all good. We can talk about other things.
Yeah, she's dead. I'm glad she's dead.
Well, we just returned to the earth, man. We're not dead.
I hope she's dead.
We're just born again.
I hope that the only earth that she returns on, some animal finds and then poops on it.
I light up a joint while I talk to her.
God.
And I say, how was your age when I first smoked? Perhaps it's time you smoke.
Oh no.
Make a persuasion.
And I hand the hag girl.
Make a persuasion check.
Did I win the persuasion?
We don't know until he rolls.
I mean, really, this is the best thing for her. She just needs to go to sleep.
I have to roll an insight check for her.
Okay. I'm just giving my reasoning for this.
No, I hear you.
All right.
Your reasoning to give a little girl a fucking joint.
Ah. It's not a drug.
In his defense, in his defense, I gave a rather big but young boy two wineskins.
Yeah, I know. Even after.
Hey, just so you know, you rolled that public.
The girl looks confusedly at it and then reaches forward and picks the small burning cigarette from your hands and then puts it up to her lips. Like this?
You got it, kiddo.
And you see her pull a way too big a draw. Way, way too big a draw. And just begins coughing immediately. And it's like, but the cough that's coming, this is like a hacking cough. Like it sounds like somebody that has been smoking every day for like 70,000 years. It is awful.
Well, I pour another glass of water for her.
As she reaches to take the glass of water from you, she greedily drinks it down and then gives it back to you. And as you take the cup, you see there is a small smear of dark something. It's like a thick fluid. It's very viscous. Is actually clinging to the outside of the cup where she put her lips to it.
Well, we all gotta die someday. I ask her if maybe it's time for a nap for her.
As you say that, you look over and she's just yawning. Both arms are in the air, kind of turning back and forth as she's doing a great big stretch. Yeah, I think that would... And just immediately just puts her head right into the pillow. She is out.
Excellent. Oh, I make a kale salad for myself.
Here comes the real Swift Panda.
Oh. Yeah, see, that was the problem. He didn't drug her up first. I make a salad and I don't know, what time is it? Am I going to bed now?
It is pretty late.
Okay. With that, I go to sleep in my own bed. You crazy people. You.
So, Sorwin, you curl up in bed, the rest of your cigarette having expended itself, and you curl up and you just go for a snooze, and you're just about to start to fall asleep when you hear a few murmurs of voices, and then the door is thrown open. And as you look up, Lola is just, she is conked out. Nothing's going to wake this girl at this point. She is out. But you sit up, and you see two humans you've never seen before. Really big guys. One of them a little taller than the other. And one of them is kind of being helped in, and he smells pretty strongly of ale. And the look on his face is completely expressionless. It is devoid of color. It is just, he's got the 1,000-yard stare. And the larger human kind of sets him down on top of the nearest bed and puts his hand on one shoulder and just looks at him for a little bit.
I notice a broken wine sack and I cast mending on it and repair it.
What a nice guy.
So I take it, excuse me, I take it off of him.
Like so as this human is setting down the other on top of the bed and doing his best to give him a little bit of what seems like support, you notice clutched in his offhand is a torn wineskin. Make a sleight of hand check. Steve-O, make a perception, or Morris, make a perception check.
Good. This could be either the best thing you could do, or the worst thing you could do.
He looks like he got bigger numbers.
He definitely got bigger numbers. He rolled a nat 20.
Okay.
So, Morris, as you are setting Arun down, you've got the wineskin clasped in your left hand, and you've got the right arm is supporting Arun, and you've just set him down into the table in this what looks like a dormitory. It's not terribly well lit, but there is enough light that's coming off of what are actually a series of bioluminescent flowers that are actually growing on the inside of this dormitory. So the only light source are these kind of pale, soft white natural light being given off by about 15 or 20 of these white blossomed flowers that are running along the roof from starting at the door and running towards the end of the room. And as you're doing this, you catch out of the corner of your eye a shadow shifting towards you. And it's reaching for whatever's in your left hand, and you spin on a heel and you turn and you look straight in the face of what appears to be an elf. No, not a half elf. Or not an elf, it's a half elf. And he's just stopped staring at you as you have now turned and looked straight at him.
I go to grab my great axe, but it's not there, as I gave it to the security.
You're right.
Wait, Sorwin is a half elf too.
You've never met this Sorwin. You don't know who he is.
I'm just kind of so this isn't me that someone's looking at, is what I'm wondering right now.
All right, you're asking for my great axe and not finding it. I give him the death stare.
I death stare you back and still proceed to try to grab it. I think I lost that.
Both of you make intimidation checks.
Shit, get some.
Okay, this has gone from best to worst thing now.
Suck it.
Uh-oh.
So, Morris, you death stare this puny half-elf that would dare try and steal from you. And you look at him. As you look him straight in the eyes, you see something. You don't know what the hell it is, but there is something that is, like, feral about this half-elf. And it's... In an instant, you go from, like, I could take this guy to, what the hell's wrong with you? And for a moment, you are actually a little bit concerned for your safety.
Holy shit, I punch him.
And like I said,
Sorwin, what's your AC? Wait, what am I? I'm pretty sure 22 hits. Okay, your AC is 11, so
it
hits.
Raging?
He's not raging. He did not say he was raging. No. Sorwin, you take 5 points of bludgeoning damage as this human that went from, like, staring you down really fiercely, all of a sudden his face goes from, like, sternness to shock and surprise and a little bit of fear, and then it's just a blur of fist as it comes at you. It catches you right in the side of the chin, and you take 5 points of bludgeoning damage.
Okay. How can I now in this little kerfuffle, try to grab the wine sack again?
Well, you can. Okay,
what, like,
so you.
What,
so what you would do is you would make an attack roll.
Okay.
So if you go to, if you open up your character sheet and just click on the attack roll for, your quarterstaff.
Oh, I don't think that's gonna be very effective against this big dude.
Well, it's you're not actually attacking with the quarterstaff. I just need you to make that roll.
Oh,
what you would do is roll a d20. You would add your dexterity modifier and your proficiency modifier.
Okay. I'm going to hope that this guy doesn't hit me again. But
I hope it knocks him out.
Because there's good intentions, even though they're not well aware yet.
Actually, you know what? Let me look up the spell mending. This might all be for, like, for shits and giggles, because if you have to touch it, then that's what matters. If you don't have to touch it, then it doesn't.
This is good to learn. I'm learning the game right now. So what do
Steve-O was helping you learn.
I understand. He punched me
by punching you in the face.
Negative response.
Yeah.
Don't sleight of hand a random person.
Well, I mean, if you got the skills for it, there's no.
Yeah. Yeah. Right?
Obviously, he doesn't.
Fucking, you don't try to steal.
Yes, you have to touch the thing you're mending.
Damn. Okay. You know what?
Okay, so make your attack roll.
Okay. How do I do that?
Are you going to do something else? Are you going to do something else?
I do something else.
Okay, what do you do?
I say, nice fucking shot, furl of fists coming at me. I was merely trying to go and assist you with your broken wine sack. Looks like you could use a mend.
I just toss it to him and go back to a rune.
Okay. Cool. I didn't get killed.
Your first night is saved.
You're lucky I didn't have my great axe on me, because that probably would have been even worse.
Okay. Okay.
It's okay. I got hit by him too.
All right.
That's okay.
So, Morris, you said you toss him the wineskin?
Yeah. And I just immediately, without saying anything, I go back to a rune.
Okay. So, Sorbin, if you would like to hit the cast button on mending, under your character sheet, you go to spells.
I'm gonna go to the bathroom real quick.
Okay. Okay. And how do I cast it?
There should be blue button.
Oh, I just hit cast. That's it.
Yep.
Okay.
Okay. So we haven't given you a description, but you've casted mending.
Okay.
So, the broken wine, or the torn wineskin, is tossed at you, and you take it, and you fold it back so that it appears to be all one piece and one together again. You clasp both hands over the tear, and you concentrate and you channel your natural magic, that which empowers you from the forces of nature itself. And the wineskin is made out of leather, so it's a naturally occurring material, much like the armor that you wear. And you can feel the fibers of the leather that begin to all of a sudden sprout and grow and weave and actually remesh and connect with each other. And Morris, as you look over, there is, as this elf, or as this half-elf opens his hands up, there are a few leaves that are actually lining his palms that very rapidly go from green to brown and then just blow away as dust in an unseen breeze, and he presents you with a perfect, pristine, undamaged wineskin.
You went to the bathroom.
Oh yeah, that's right, he did that.
Thanks.
Thanks.
For the time being, we'll say he takes it and says thank you.
I'm back.
Okay.
You've been presented with a fully repaired wineskin.
I give him a nod and go back to a rune.
Okay. I then ask the other gentleman in the room who just stormed in, how can I be of assistance? I say, sock it to me.
You're asking this to the guy that was put down on the bed?
Didn't someone else come in too? With
The two of them came in, and this big guy that you've had this conflict with, he was kind of helping the other person to the bed and like sat him down.
That
person is just non-responsive.
Oh, okay.
He's conscious. Like, he's awake. He's clearly awake. He's just not responding to anybody.
Okay. I ask more this gentleman, this large gentleman that just punched me, how I can also be of assistance.
Have I noticed what's her name? Lola in the room yet?
You look over and you see Lola and she is sound asleep.
So I do see her?
Yep, she's right there.
Alright, then I'll guide Game's character out of the room and into just basically out of the building so I can talk to him without them overhearing. And I'll explain to him how Arun just found out his brother was dead, and it's probably best not to mess with him, because I won't be able to stop him if he gets pissed off. And then I'll explain to him how Lola is probably a hag, and will soon transform into a hag, and the best thing we can do at the time is to make sure no one harms her.
I said that. I say that's the plan.
If you don't like bears, I'd suggest not sleeping tonight.
I don't have a problem with animals.
So while this exchange is going on, Theon, as you were heading back from the herbalists, you passed by the dormitory, or the kind of lodgings for the druids, and you heard a small kerfuffle, and what sounded like somebody's jaw getting hit.
Oh, yeah, was a distinct sound.
That was loud.
It is a distinct sound. And then shortly after that, and a couple of words of muted conversation, the door is pushed open, and you see Morris standing there with a half-elf you do not recognize. And the two of them share a few words back and forth.
Whoa. I don't recognize him?
You don't recognize this half-elf, no.
Damn. But he is a half-elf.
He is a half-elf.
I walk up to him, and I say... Well, wait, is Mo still talking with him?
Mo is right there. They appear to have just finished whatever they were talking about.
And I just walked up as well?
You did.
I go up there, and I look at him, and I say, a half-elf? Here in the glade? I grew up here as well, and... I've never met a half-elf. Where are you from?
Oh, I am not from around here. I was born in the human city of... Is there a human city?
There are tons of human cities. You can go ahead and make up a name.
Oh, I didn't know that Baldur's Gate was based upon this. No, I never played it.
Yep, Baldur's Gate is a city in Dungeons & Dragons. Actually, the party left from Baldur's Gate in the very first episode.
Huh. I did not know that. I should...
Fun seeing them
you
starting
weren't
to talk,
supposed to know that.
Fun seeing them starting to talk, I'll walk into the back into the room with Arun and Ola and attempt to get Arun to go to sleep again.
It's at this time that the druid, kind of, who initially kind of charged you, Sorwin, with looking after Lola, he comes back around the corner and seems a little bit startled to have run into two other people he wasn't expecting right here. Ah, I see you've met my apprentice. Sorwin, these are our guests, as he eyes up and down Morris and Theon. It has been wrong of me to keep you sheltered here, but understand, it is for good reason. I was hoping to introduce the two of you perhaps tomorrow morning, but it would appear that fate has intervened on my behalf. Sorwin, much will happen in the next coming days. I would like a more active presence outside the bounds of this village that I must tend to. But I have taught you much of what you need to know. The rest you must learn, and nature herself will be your tutor. I'm charging you to go with these men. You are to represent our interest and see to it that this village does not come to harm.
I accept this charge. If they will accept me.
The druid then turns towards Morris, turns towards Theon. Well?
When I inspect the repaired wineskin...
It is perfect. There is no sign of any damage.
Is it perfect?
It is. There is zero sign of any damage has ever occurred to it.
Then I'll grumble, I'm fine with it, and walk back into the room.
And I'll kind of say I've only just joined myself. I don't really feel like I have too much of a say on who joins.
The druid seems a little taken aback at that. You are companions, are you not?
We are companions, and our journeys compel ourselves to journey with each other. And if that's the case here, then I have no problem with it as well.
Well, the druid extends his hand to Sorwin. Sorwin, consider yourself compelled.
You said these two people and fates. Who were you talking to?
The druid said that in reference to yourself and to Morris. So you get the impression that it was always this druid's plan to assign his apprentice to your group. But from what he revealed, he was planning on doing that probably tomorrow and not tonight. But it seems like it's going to happen no matter what.
Interesting.
That's a good question. Where are you and Mindartis? The last thing the two of you saw was Arun's reaction to looking into the mirror and his seemingly going into a rage, very much like what Morris does in battle, being calmed down and then drawn away and off to the dormitory, leaving the two of you alone in the grove, standing beneath the boughs of the Argent Oak.
I go and up to the guards that I gave my weapons to get them back.
The guard nods, and he hands you back your weapons. He pauses momentarily before giving you back the bow. I do not know how you came by this, but if you wield it, you are defending these people. You will do so honorably, or you will deal with me.
I nod.
Am I anywhere around in the area?
You're not.
Okay. Thank God for that.
The elf then reaches forward and thrusts the bow against your chest, and you take it from him. Let's see. Oh yeah, it was Honos and Mindartis that arrived at the same time. Your companions, their gear is in here. And he kind of indicates to a chest. We will confiscate these weapons if they are not claimed before you leave. Keep that in mind. He then turns on a heel and walks away.
Who else gave their weapons in? Was it just Big Mo?
Yep.
There are still guards that are posted around the glade the grove itself, but none of them appear to be looking directly at you. You're gonna grab the big great axe? All right. Are you trying to not be noticed as you do this? Okay, make a deception check. I'm pulling out all sorts of NPCs I didn't think I was going to have to. This is fun.
What number does he need to get for this to, like, I don't understand.
It depends. It depends on the NPC. I think HPG will usually roll for the NPC, and if Joe has scored higher for than the NPC that HPG rolled for, then Joe would win the roll.
So Honos, you swear that this guard would have totally noticed you, but apparently not. He is just, there must be something about his mask, it's blocking his vision or something, but you're able to reach in, you're able to grab that axe and just walk away. Okay, so it's scraping lightly, and you're amazed that you're not getting a reaction out of anybody, but it would appear that no one seems to be stopping you. You suave motherfucker, you pull it off. Alright, so you're now dragging a great big axe. It's almost your height. And as you are, in fact, walking, you are dragging and creating a small little furrow through the earth mound.
Are they leaving the grove or entering the grove?
I don't know. Are you guys leaving or entering the grove? Where are you going? You saw Morris and Arun head off towards this end of the grove and then head around a corner. You heading there? All right. So, as Mindardus and Honos... Mindardus, I'm assuming you're going with him, or do you have something else you would like to do?
No, I'm going.
Okay. So, as Mindardus and Honos, they round the corner, and they see a descent via staircase kind of downwards a little bit into a structure that seems to have not been built, but grown. As many branches, twigs, boughs, roots, all of it just seem to kind of meld into this one structure, this kind of longhouse. And as you open the door, you see the interior is lit lightly with bright white flowers that are giving off a little bit of light. They're bioluminescent in their nature. The floor is compacted earth and just kind of like hard-pressed dirt. And scattered about are many familiar faces. You see Arun, you see Morris, you see Theon. You see Lola, who is sound asleep on the bed. There's a funny smell in the air, but none of you are able to quite pick it out. And
God damn it.
You do not recognize one individual in the room, a half-elf. And Sorwin, why don't you go ahead and describe what you look like?
I am tall for a half-elf. I'm 6'1". I have a scar on my left cheek. I'm young, 20, early 30. I have a cloak on with a hood. Leather armor is on. There's a staff on my back. There's a dark leather boots. That I still have on, even though I was going to sleep.
What's your hair color, your eye color, your complexion?
I'm a pale complexion elf. I have dark green eyes. Hair complexion is just also a dark wood color.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right, so Honos and Mindardus, as you walk into the room, this is the individual that you see before you, the only one that you don't recognize. Arun and Lola are just conked out at this point.
I give it a hug.
Sorwin, you observe the unusual ritual of this very large man hugging a very large axe.
And then I will hug... Is it Sorin?
Sorwin, yes.
Sorwin. Then I'll hug Sorwin for bringing me the X. Then I'll go to sleep cuddling the X. Spooning it.
Alright, is everybody going to sleep?
I have so many questions.
Ask away.
Who are you people, and why are you in this house? I believe you've been getting a contact high. I live here. Perhaps we should just go to bed. I've been training as an apprentice druid for nearly all the years that you can remember in distant jungles, and more recently, the forest you currently occupy.
Where the shit did that come from?
I think we're all a little high right now.
What the hell?
So the sleeping arrangements are as such. There's five beds on each side of the building. Lola is in the one to the left of the door. Urun is in the one to the right of the door. Sorwin usually sleeps at the rear left, at the very back of the building. So there are 7 other beds. Where are you guys sleeping?
I would like the rear right.
I'm gonna sleep as close to Urun as possible, just because I understand what could happen if he has some sort of a night terror.
Okay.
I'm gonna sleep as far away from Urun as possible. Just because I understand what happens if he has a night terror.
Wait, how do you know what happens?
Don't.
Oh no, so you don't know what happens. He, as far as you know, this is just a very angry kid.
Still gonna sleep away from him.
Mindardus, where are you sleeping?
Whatever's left.
All right, we'll see you. You bunk to the next one down from where Theon is. So Sorwin, Theon, and Honos make a perception check.
Oh, what was that?
Wait, so that was Sorwin, Honos, and Mindardus? They did the perception checks?
You didn't say Mindardus.
Oh, I'm sorry. Mindardus, please make a perception check.
Why'd you roll stealth check?
All right. As everyone begins to slowly drift off to sleep, Mindardus, you are the only person that is close enough. You hear Theon reciting something to himself under his breath. You can't pick out the words, it's too faint, but you do distinctly hear him saying something to himself. You are able to discern that it's not Elvish, it's not common, it's something else. It's a language you've never heard before, but you don't hear anything else.
Mm.
This is just as your perception starts to fade and everyone's consciousness begins to kind of shut down as everyone goes to sleep for the evening.
Beep, boop.
And I think that's a good place to stop for the night.
What?
Huh?
It's like 11:30, man.
That's like the earliest we've ever went to bed.
You'll live.
Yeah, you guys will be fine.
We like storytelling with HPG.
I really enjoy it, too. I need to have story to tell you guys, though.
HPG, my English teacher has required me to take this class because I learned so many new vocab words. I definitely need my credit fun. Hours, goddammit.
So, game, sorry for making you wait for so long before there was anything that incorporated you.
No, just... I think I was nice to... It was nice to, like, get slowly, like, brought into it. Yeah.
Okay, well, that's good. I'm glad you had a good
time.
Will
you be back next time?
Maybe I will. Maybe I'll be back as an animal, you know? Maybe you won't even see me.
Huh? What does that even mean?
I can just follow you as a crocodile or any quarter-health creature.
All I know is your master or whatever just fucking, convinced you to be with us.
Oh, there was no convincing. He just flat out assigned him.
I know. Yeah. That's why I said sentenced.
I like our
oh,
meeting,
sentenced.
Though.
Sorry, they said convinced.
Our yeah. meeting was awesome.
I promise a Shalala Moonbeam right on your balls when you're not looking.
He's grinding his axe, man. There is going to be vengeance someday. Yeah.
No. Well, it'll be a. Here's one back for you.
Don't do it. Like I said, I got punched in the face too.
But maybe when we're fighting a horde of something, I might just miss.
Don't, and then your miss will turn into your death.
Don't do it, man. This guy like strikes for fucking 50
Wait
damage.
A minute.
So game, we generally have our games on Saturdays, once every 2 weeks.
Okay.
So if you can try to stick to the schedule, I would really appreciate it. If you can't, just let me know in advance, and I'll try and come up with something.
Yeah, Yeah, I could even do it more than that, but that's cool too. That works.
Well, if I have... That is where Joe's campaign comes in. Also, if I have enough material prepped that I'm ready to do it the next weekend, I will let you guys know. As it stands right now, we covered a lot of the story points that I wanted to cover tonight. We didn't get to do any of the combat that I was anticipating, but that's fine. And I'll save that for next time.
Well, let's do it now.